Hello again, this is Kai from Meeples Magazine with another video review. So put on your best winter clothes, because today things get frosty. The game today is Mountains of Madness by Rob Davio. And the story of the game is pretty much the same as in the inspiring story At the Mountains of Madness by H.P. Lovecraft. There was a discovery in the Antarctic that on top of a huge mountain range there is a city from a pre-human civilization, so obviously someone has to go there and have a look at it. People get there, things go crazy pretty quickly, the city is all these beautiful Lovecrafty things like non-Euclidean, cyclopean, squammers, and other words not necessarily good for people with a squeamish vocabulary, and someone makes it back out just with his life and sanity barely intact to tell the tale. Our brave explorers arrive at the coast of the Antarctic mountain range, and the goal is for them to get all the way up to the top where the edge of madness is and escape with their plane, and on the way to collect more relics than they collect wound cards, which is a bit difficult because they start with some wound cards in their deck already, so they have to find relics or they can escape and still lose the game. On the way up the mountain, our explorers stumble from one problem to the next, and as you would expect, the higher up they go, things only get worse. Every problem they go to comes in the form of one of these tiles. Each of these tiles has challenges that the explorers need to complete. It comes with a potential reward if they manage at least one of them, and if they don't manage one of them, then bad things happen, people get injured, someone goes crazy, you know, the usual. Each of the challenges has an icon that is needed and the number of those icons that is needed that the players have to cooperatively put down in their cards. Equipment cards look like this, so this would be two of the crates needed for the challenge here. To overcome the challenges, players have a handful of equipment cards to play. And unlike other games of a similar style, they can talk freely about what cards they have. So there's none of that nonsense, I have a few crates, but not too many, but more than just a little. No, you can just say the number. The restriction here is, you can only talk about them from the moment the challenge tile is turned over, until someone puts down the first equipment card. As soon as that happens, you have to stop talking. And if that wasn't bad enough, there's always our friend the sand timer. You only have 30 seconds from turning the challenge tile to putting down the last card. When the 30 seconds are over and everyone hopefully played the cards they needed to, we look at the stack of cards that were just played and compare the icons there to the icons on the challenge tile. If the number of icons is in the range that is given, then the challenge counts as completed. If it's more or fewer than that, then the challenge is a failure. If any of the challenges on the card is completed, then we have a success and we get the reward. That in the case of this is the specimen A, so we would get one of the relics that we need to get out with. But there are other rewards, like we get to heal, meaning remove injury cards from our deck. We get to get leadership's token back, more on those in a moment. And sometimes we get lucky and get to spy ahead what challenges are still waiting for us. On the other hand, for every challenge that is not completed, we have to take a penalty. There we have a choice of either rolling the penalty dice, that has three equally bad outcomes of taking injuries to our shared deck, to losing more of the leadership tokens, or to having to discard equipment cards that will make us reshuffle the deck sooner, which is also not good for us. The other option is less good, but more fun, because that's where you get to the Lovecraftian party game part of this game. People go slightly crazy! When you start going crazy, you have to draw a level 1 madness card. These are generally fun, but not really all that bad when you're playing. For example, this one makes you a cheerleader, so when the timer starts, you have to high-five everyone before you can do anything else. Takes a bit of time, but it's not so bad. If you have a madness card already, then you get one of a higher level. Like this level 2 card that makes you a pacifist, that every time someone says weapon, you have to yell and then not speak anymore until the send timer runs out. Great in a cooperative game. Level 3, even more fun. This one is relatively harmless actually, you just get nervous and have to drum the fingers of one hand all the time, even while playing cards to the shared pile. But there are much worse level 3 madnesses than this. The worst we have encountered so far was that every time someone asks you a yes or no question, you have to answer yes. Yeah, that's as awesome as it sounds when you're trying to plan which cards can be played. Some other level 3 madnesses that really make everything more fun and much easier to get to the right number of things. You could become compulsive. Every time someone says a number, you have to say the number that is one higher. Yeah, just imagine, someone says, I can play 4 crates, and you have to say 5. That will make planning great, isn't it? Or you can have a calendar madness. You cannot say numbers anymore, you have to replace them with the name of their month. Yay, I can play March weapons, but I cannot play April weapons. People can get behind it, but it's not helpful. Or there's this one that makes you speak like this all the time because peanut butter sticks the tongue to the top of your mouth. If you could understand that, I might actually buy you a coffee if I meet you. That's all fun and games so far, but in the limited time you have, you will also want to make some difficult strategic choices. For example, you can decide that you want to fail a challenge because you have spied ahead and you know that you will need many of the icons you would need for that on the more to the top of the mountain. So collect them early, fail the challenge, take the punishment, but you know when you arrive up here, you have the cards that you need. That's especially the case when you get the arcane equipment cards as a reward that give you 10 of whatever icon you need. It's also a good reason to spy ahead because then you know which of these you actually want to pick up. The 30 second time limit for each challenge is not the only limit you have to contend with. You also have to watch these guys, leadership tokens. You only have 6 of them, they are very useful, and when you run out of them, you lose the game. You can discard these things at the beginning of the round to make one player ignore their madness card for this round. You can use them to get another 30 seconds for playing cards. You can use them to have a higher hand limit when you redraw cards. Every time you have to discard one of these. The only way to get them back, and at the same time the only way to shuffle your equipment deck, is to return one of these to the box, then take all the rest back to use them. So every time you have to reshuffle the equipment deck, you lose one leadership token. When the last one of them goes to the box, the game is over and it's not good for you. Running out of leadership tokens is one way to lose the game, but as you'd expect from a cooperative game, there are more of those. If you have to draw an injury card and that deck is empty, then, well, you're screwed as well. And even if you make it off the mountain but have more injuries than you have relics, then you still lose the game. Oh, and did I mention that having those relics with you is not only good for you either, they all give you some nice token that you put on your player board that makes something impossible for you. For example, you might not be able to discard leadership tokens to get extra 30 seconds anymore. I would say that Mountains of Madness is not quite a game for everyone because some of these madness cards really make you behave silly, and if that is not something you enjoy, then it's not a game you will have a lot of fun with. On the other hand, if you don't have a problem being silly, then it's a really, really cool take on the restricted communication that many cooperative games have, because you can just say what you want as long as you stick to your madness card. That is just fun to play, really. It's also a very good game with a strategic component because you want to plan ahead your route and how many places you explore. If you don't do that well, then you're basically not going to make it. And the time limit of 30 seconds together with the madness cards really, really makes it stressful in a very good way. Of course, very few games are perfect, and there are a few minor things that I dislike in Mountains of Madness as well. One is that they could have made more of the theme. For example, you don't see anything of the pre-human city, you don't meet the Shoggoths that appear in the short story. There was more potential to use the Lovecraftian theme there. The other thing is that you don't have much scope to adjust the difficulty. There is the expert mode of the game where you keep all your madness cards instead of discarding the lower level ones, but that is the only thing that you can do to make the game harder. So once you're proficient at that, you don't have anywhere to go and you just play for fun. But other than that, it's a really cool game. It's an innovative concept that we really enjoyed playing. Definitely profits from the art by Miguel Coimbra. That is always a plus in any game. So yeah, this is one of the very good games we got from Essen last year. That was our second ever video review. I hope you see a bit of improvement there. If you dislike something about this review, if you think we did something better the other time, or if you really, really loved this review or this game, leave a comment down there. We'd be more than happy to hear from you, and see you next time.